Buddhist ordination is one of the main cornerstones to survive and to sustain Buddha Dharma since the historical Buddha Gautama taught to his followers. So the ordination to the man and woman is given in two sort of ways. First in Tibetan, it says ngonchok, that means ordination that is that took place during the historical Buddhist time, and tachok, that is the ordination, you know, the, given by after the Buddha's lifetime. You know, the, of course, Buddha himself instructed how to give the ordination. So the during the Buddha's time, to give the ordination, particularly, you know, the bhikshu and bhikshuni, that is the full ordination for the man and for the woman, monks and nuns, during the Buddha's time, quite often, and you know, the, there were any rites to perform to give the ordination. Just simply, for example, there are several occasions. I'll give you one or two examples. You know, simply Buddha himself asked somebody a few questions. Out of that process of asking question, that particular person is ordained. Or Buddha just simply give a robe to a person and that person is ordained without any going through any, you know, the ordination rites. And that is only during the Buddha's time. Only during the Buddha's time, not after Buddha's time. So the second, you know, the what you call the ordination, which is after Buddha passed away, it is to perform that ordination. The entire ordination, giving ordination, you know, the process should be follow a particular rite. Particular rites, and then so that is common to all the Buddhist Vinaya traditions. Although, you know, the soon after Buddha passed away, there were 18 Vinaya traditions, but nowadays, you know, the present time, it seems there are only two remains, you know, on this planet. The one which followed by the Theravadan Buddhist traditions, like Sri Lanka, Burma, or modern time called a slightly different name, and other, you know, the Theravadan tradition. And it is called in Sanskrit, in Tibetan it is called Nedin Deva, and in Sanskrit it is called Sitavara tradition. And now the ordination, the second ordination, which is still remain intact, the tradition still remain intact, is the ordination followed by the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. And it is called, in Tibetan, it is called Shitamje Yobamawa. And in Sanskrit, it is called Mola Sarvasadin school. So both schools, which are still remain intact, you know, to ordain monks and nuns, mainly particularly fully ordained, are the only monks, sadly, you know, they follow particular rites. And that is really, really important part of the, from the receiver side to follow, and the giving side, giver who give, the abbots and the acharyas who give, the monks, other monks who give. Ordination to follow the rite precisely is extremely important part, and so the, what I'm going to do, I'm going to briefly to explain that how that rite is performed in Tibetan tradition, which I'm a little bit familiar with, and what I'm going to do, I will explain that based on Gyatso, the 14th century great Tibetan master, in his 18 volumes of writing, and this first volume, in Tibetan volume Ga, in the first volume, there are two texts related to that to the the ordination, and these two texts, in Tibetan it is called Gelong Gesul Gelapcha Namzit Dema, and then second one is called Gelong Gelapcha Namzit Dema. So I want to read the second one, which is Gelong Gelapcha. It is advice for the fully ordained monks, and that it is called Namzit Dema. Namzit Dema is the place name. It seems he composed this text at a place called Namzit Dema, which is not very far from modern Lhasa. In fact, that place where he composed this text, this advice for the fully ordained monks, place called Namzit Dema, is a during his time was a very important monastic study institution, which is established, founded by a great 13th century Tibetan master called Archangchubishi. He found that. So Tsongkhapa seems composed that text in there. So text itself is called Namzit Dema, given the place name. So in that text, what Tsongkhapa gave, which I want to briefly to say the outlines, how the ordination rite is performed, and here you have to identify the people who are going to receive. First one is people who are going to receive the ordination, to identify them and their mental conditions, all those things is the first one. Second one is the person who are given the ordination, like abbot and so on and so forth. Then third major outline here is the after receiving the ordination, how to practice, how to keep the vows, the precepts they have received from the ordination. So those are the three major outlines. What I'm interested in here is the second one. Second one, which is, what are the conditions? What are the conditions to be met to perform the ordination? To perform the ordination. And I think that's very important. And here, first of all, if you are ordaining, if the ordination is performing in a place, what traditionally called a central place, central, that in the sense of where the Vinaya teachings are still extremely active, there are monks, nuns performing three major monastic activities. That is twice in month, performing the listening the Vinaya Sutra. Secondly, yearly, keeping the raining retreat, and then thirdly, yearly after the raining retreat, there is a particular practice called Gaye. When these three activities are performed in a particular place, and that place is called central area. So if the ordination rite is performing in that kind of place, now in that rite there must be 10 fully ordained monks who are in the process of performing the ordination rites. Without that, if there's only 8 or 9, ordination rites cannot be performed. That's very clear, and this is what Tsongkhapa, not what I'm saying. It is Tsongkhapa's. Make very clear. I just want to read in Tibetan. It says, "Sumbala gindunla." So Sumba is the third sort of outline. yu u su ju dang takob du mena ne gone tang chang wa. So yu u that I just mentioned, the central area, there must be 10 fully ordained monks to perform that. And if, you know, the place is difficult to have 10 monks, then at least there must be 5 fully ordained monks. Without that, the ordination, you know, the what's called rite cannot be performed. And these fully ordained either 10 in the central area and the other area 5, itself also must have some particular what's called the qualifications. These 10 or 5 monks, you know, they have received their full ordination more than 10 years ago. There shouldn't be any disruption between that 10 years. Tenbei yun den, that is, the tenbei yun den means the qualities of stability of their own ordination in order to give that ordination to the others. Kebei yun den, those monks who are in the ordination, giving ordination to the other men, they should be extremely wise, extremely well, or sort of well educated to perform the ordination rites. Kebei yun den, tenbei yun den, zunbei yun den. And the third qualification is they are extremely mentally, extremely well, sort of what you call the compassionate to the people who are there, who them are giving ordination. As a receive ordination, the historical Buddha gave 3 main important things to be followed, which I briefly mentioned earlier. You know, as ordained monks and nuns, they should follow twice a month, you know, the sojong, purification. That is through listening the Padimosha Sutra. That's very important as ordained monks and nuns. And secondly, observing the reigning retreat, yamne. And thirdly, after the yamne, gagye. These 3, the activities are key factor for the Buddhist ordained monks and nuns to follow. And that's the very important part of the monastic members' activities.